This podcast is brought to you by LMU Munich.
So let's continue the lecture where we ended the previous one. We had our MHB bar amplitude. So let me actually go directly to the twister space. Okay. So this was what we got for the MHB bar amplitude. And remember, we wanted to denote this as a Y vertex. Now, in the most probably in the remaining of this lecture, and perhaps at the beginning of tomorrow, well, it depends, we will see. We want to consider the theory in the planar limit. So we will take n to be infinite, the rank of the Lie algebra. And therefore, it would be convenient to use a color decomposition for the amplitudes. So the way we are going to do it is, of course, very standard, and you all know it. But let me write this as we probably did it many times already in these lectures or in this school. Okay. So I'm going to write the structure constants as the commutator. I'm expanding the commutator. Now note the following. We said that this was antisymmetric in 1 and 2. Okay. So, well, it's not clear. It's not completely obvious from here. Here it looks like the object was permutation invariant. But we know that in momentum space it was antisymmetric in 1 and 2. Okay. And therefore, if we call this, let me call it A123. Hat. We can now put trace of TA1, TA2, TA3 together with this object. And now we have a minus sign and what we can do is to use the antisymmetry of this object in all its indices in order to write it in the same order that we have here. So we have 3 and 2, and here we have 2 and 3, so we can reverse it and pay a minus sign. Therefore, we will get a minus A hat 1, 3, and 2. And this thing goes with this, or in other words, we can just put a plus sign here. And this gives the standard color decomposition of this amplitude, where we write it as a sum over all possible color orderings. In this case, there are only two independent ones because the amplitudes are cyclic, and this is what we usually get. So from now on, these pictures will have an ordering, the ordering that I'm giving there, and I'm going to be discussing color order partial amplitudes. So it's exactly the same object I have there, but now with a particular ordering and no structure constants. So from now on, you will not see any structure constants in the amplitudes. And they are all color order. So you have all seen this color decomposition, right? So that's standard for everybody. Except for Stefan. Okay, so this is very good. What else do we want to do? Well, so on this blackboard, I believe, we had, now we can write the color order MHB amplitude. In fact, I should be more precise. So I should write it like this. Now, let's note two things. The first one, let's actually do it here. The first one is the following. Recall that in momentum space, if you have a null vector on a null particle, we have lambdas and lambda tildes, but they define the same momentum as any of these pairs, okay? So from the momentum point of view, we have to mod out by this rescaling, okay? So what happens here? Well, you see that the Z, the bosonic part, is something that has a lambda component and a mu component. What's the scaling now? Under a little group transformation, what happens to ZA? Well, this is also something very nice that happens, right? The mu A is the conjugate variable to lambda tilde. In other words, mu tilde goes like derivative of lambda with respect to lambda tilde, right? So it transforms like T. So the great thing is that the ZA transforms as TZA. Right? But you see that if we also rescale the eta components by TA, eta A, okay, so if we do these two transformations at the same time, we get something that is invariant under the scaling, because we have something that is supersymmetric. In other words, the physical configurations only depend on the equivalence classes of. These are called, I told you, the bosonic ones were called twisters, so let's call these ones super twisters. Well, if you have a vector of objects and you can rescale and your physical configuration doesn't change, we say that the corresponding physical object is defined on the projective space, defined by these variables. So what would be the projective space defined by this? Well, if you only had four bosonic components, and we are allowed to rescale the four bosonic components, what would that space be? What's CP3? Very good. But we also have four fermionic components. So we say that the super twisters live in CP3. So that would be the bosonic part. And the fermionic part, we denote it as a slash 4. Okay? So this is a supersymmetric space. But all it means is that it's a space of objects like this, identified modulo by any rescaling, any bosonic rescaling, meaning that TA has to belong to C star. Okay, so they define the same point. So that's why they live in CP3/4. Very good. So that's the behavior of these objects. And we decided, by definition, that these amplitudes are denoted by a black vertex. Okay. Now we can start have having, we can start to have some fun with these diagrams. So let's start with the simplest possible. So what do we want to do? We want to build diagrams just like Feynman diagrams, okay? But the building blocks would be these objects. Now, we only know how to define these objects on shell when the external particles are twisters, right? Up to date, nobody knows how to extend this off shell. So we cannot do anything that is off shell like in Feynman diagrams. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? Well, it turns out to be a good thing, and we will see why. So what can we do with these things? Well, let's take two black vertices. Particles 1, 2, 3, and 4, and say particles internal 1 and internal 2. Okay. How can we merge these two diagrams to make something sensible that now depends on four particles? Well, one possibility would be, given that these points live in twister space, we just simply be to identify these two twisters. Okay? So we will define the merging what would be the a better word? We can solve diagrams together by identifying two twisters. Well, that's almost the only operation we can do here, or the only operation that at least I can think of. Maybe there is something else, but this is the most natural, certainly. But how can we do that? If you have one twister and you have another one that differ by a rescaling, they are supposed to be the same twister. So when we identify two twisters, we should allow for this guy to be a rescaling of this one. So we have to define a delta function that identifies things up to a rescaling. So we need a projective delta function. Well, what could this be? Well, we don't usually do it like this, but it turns out to be extremely natural. It's actually, well, no, maybe I shouldn't do it like this. Yes, sorry. So how do we do it? We need a delta function that takes two twisters, say twisters A and B, or in this particular case, 1 and 2, and our delta function is supposed to have support whenever these two guys are proportional to each other. Well, if we want that, that statement translated in equations would be something like this. But any rescaling, we don't care which rescaling, okay? And given that this is supersymmetric and doesn't scale, we also have to remove the scaling. And this is a way we're going to define a projective delta function of Zi, Z, or Z1 and Z2. Okay? So what is the property of this projective delta function? Well, the main property is that, just as any delta function, if you integrate over the space of projective twisters, or the project or the space of twisters, which is a projective space. So we have to integrate over the CP3/4. That's how I denote it here, 3/4. Our new fancy projective delta function times any function of zi of z1, this gives f of z2. Okay? Now that we know this, these are all the ingredients we need to start putting together smaller diagrams and build bigger diagrams, larger diagrams. So let's give it a shot with our new object and put these two guys together.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
That T over there is a complex variable, right?
That T over there is a complex, yeah, in general it's a complex variable, yes.
So the integral, is it like a contour integral or?
Yes, there is a fancier way of defining this. A fancier way of defining this is defining this as an element of some cohomology group. Okay? But at this point, I'm just going to use it as a... Yeah, there is a way of making this mathematically rigorous, but I'm not going to do it because it would take too much time. And I'm not gonna. It's not gonna buy me anything. Yeah, you should. Well, it's a physicist delta function. Right?
Well, I guess what worries me is that.
Yeah, there are many things to worry about. Yes.
Well, I seem to lose one complex dimension, but only integrate over a real one. So I seem to lose two.
No, well, the T should be, well, if it makes you happier, let's think about the Z's, the twister space as a real projective space. So it's an R3/4, RP3/4.
Okay.
We could do that. I mean, in fact, you should have complained earlier, right? Because I was doing a Fourier transform, right? So what do you mean by this Fourier transform? Complex variables. But you lost your chance. That was your only chance. Okay. Since you took that, okay, so let's give it a shot. Let's see. So we are supposed to take our objects there. So we have, say, T1, T2, DT1. Sorry, this is a terrible notation, especially for when you have to say it. So we have this. We have delta 4/4. This is one of the vertices, right? The other vertex would be and I shouldn't forget that. Maybe we should come out with a notation for that, but that there is a volume of GL1 here. Okay. So we shouldn't forget that there is a volume of GL1, which basically tells us that we can gauge fix to one anything that we like, right? So since I miss a chance of writing volume here, it's not going to fit. Let's actually gauge fix already to something. So we have to gauge fix. So gauge fix the GL1s. Any preferences? No? Okay. So I'm going to choose. I'm going to choose to gauge fix, say, this to 1. Is that a good choice? Maybe not. Maybe let's do T1. Okay. So T1 disappears from here. And from here. Here, let me choose to gauge fix, say T3 equals to 1. So this one disappears from here, and it disappears from here. Okay? But that's not our object. Okay? We still have to integrate over the internal ones and use our super fancy delta function. Right? So we have to integrate out the internal particles. So our super delta, our fancy delta function is behaving as if it was a propagator. So it's kind of an on-shell propagator. Well, using our definition, we can immediately integrate out one of the two. We can choose anything we like. So let's integrate out Z1 because it appears here already. Well, let's do it here. Well, let's actually keep Z1. Let's integrate out the other one. So we have dt2. Can anyone see what we're going to do next? Can you guess? Any guesses? What would be the next step? Using this one, combined with this, to produce another delta function, another projective delta function. Excellent. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to use dti over ti delta 4/4 of this thing. To get a delta 3/4 of Z1 plus T2 Z2 comma Zi. Okay? So that integration with this delta function, we get a projective delta function, and now we can just perform the integrals. So we got rid of this, and with the delta function, we get rid of this. And the answer is integral T2 over T2, T4 over T4, T2. And what do we get? 4/4 of Z3 plus T4 Z4 plus So you see, maybe my gauge choice here wasn't that nice. Yeah, very good. So let's change my gauge fixing here. It doesn't matter, right? It's a gauge. I mean, there is no wrong gauge, right? I mean, if you have a gauge invariance, there is no such a thing as a wrong gauge. There is such a thing as an inconvenient gauge, and things like convenient gauges, right? So I chose an inconvenient gauge. So I should choose. What would be the most convenient one? This one equal to 1, right? That would be more convenient. Okay. So we do the same thing here. Now we're in business, right? Because we get a T3 here. And we replace this thing by Z1 plus T2 Z2. What would be the next step? If I had a chocolate, I would give it to whoever guesses the next step. This doesn't look very nice, right? It would look even better.
Use some T for
Excellent. Introduce a redundancy. Now we are in the business of redundancies, so why not? You were already happy with a volume of GL1, so let's do it again. And let's relabel the T's. Well, actually, I don't have to relabel the T. Oh, sorry. Yeah, this one has to be relabeled. This was wrong. OK? So just introduce a T1. And guess what we got? OK. So that's our first on-shell diagram. But now we can compute an infinite number of them. Right? Well, the first observation is the following. Look that this looks completely permutation invariant in the four labels. So if we denote the operation we did as joining these two lines, what would have happened if we had started with this? What would be the answer? Anyone? Yeah, it should be the same, right? Because we started with this, and now we lost information about who was here and who was there. So somehow, this on-shell diagram is the same as this one, OK? So we just discovered one of the first properties of on-shell diagrams. Whenever you have vertices that are of the same color, because the same thing can be done here, you can take them, merge them, and expand them in any way you like, and you get the same answer. Okay? So that's what I'm going to call the merge and expand operation. I took care of that already. I told you, I'm only going to consider planar objects, right? So there is only S and T, there is no U channel. Okay, so merge and expand, first rule. Whenever you see something like that, you can merge, expand, and you get the same answer. Okay? Now, next thing is that we can immediately construct an infinite number of these guys, because this four-particle object looks pretty much like the original three-particle one. So we can now attach another one here. And what do you think is going to happen? So now I'm going to do the following. I'm going to consider this diagram, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. It's not all trivalent, sorry?
Color order.
Ah, okay. There is some color ordering for which this is correct. Okay. Oops. Yeah, I never told you which one was my color ordering, right? This is fine. Okay. So what's the answer for this? Well, the answer turns out to be, you can just repeat the same operations, and you get the product of dTa over TA, delta 4 slash 4, the sum over the TA's ZA. Well, why stop here up to any number m? Okay, so we just computed an infinite number of on-shell diagrams. The same goes through in this case. Of course, we can make any tree of y vertices, and we will get the same answer, but now in terms of w's. What would be the natural next step? If you're in the business of making diagrams like this, you have black and white vertices. You know how to compute any tree made out of only black guys, any tree made out of only white guys. It turns out that if you try a loop of only black guys or white guys, you get zero. So that's an exercise. you get something that immediately vanishes because of supersymmetry. The supersymmetric delta functions cannot be satisfied, so you get immediately zero. So any loop, so here is an exercise. Any loop with all whites or black vertices vanishes identically. Okay? So what's the next step? That was preventing the question, the answer to my question of, well, go and do loops. So, well, the natural next step is to combine black and white, right? But it's kind of funny, how can we combine black and white? These guys, the black guys, are defined in Z space, and the white guys are defined in W space. So it's like mixing oil and water. It's going to be hard, right? Unless we take one of the two and we bring it to the other space, okay? So I could once again ask you which one you want, but I'll only ask you, can you guess what I'm going to do? So which one are you going to choose to take to the other space? Well, it wouldn't be smart to swap both. So the next step is to put together black and white guys. So we have to take, let's take black vertices from Z space to W space. And the reason I'm going to do it like this and not the other way around will become clear in a second. It will have to do with the definition of the R charge. Have you seen own? You haven't? No, you haven't done supersymmetric amplitudes, right? So you haven't talked about R charge. But you have talked about the MHV degree, right? So, yeah, okay, fine. It's the same thing. But this will precisely match the MHV degree. If we do it the other way around, it would match the MHV bar degree, okay? So since we all talk about MHV, NMHV, and so on, we will have to do this in order to keep with that notation. So how do we do this? Well, let's actually do it to our integrals, to this object. So we want to take our new, since it doesn't matter what the tree is, I'm going to collapse all those guys, and I'm going to represent them as a single black vertex with valency n, let's say n, okay? Because it doesn't matter how I expand it. So since that information is irrelevant, I'll just put everything in terms of a single black vertex. And this guy will be represented by that formula. But now I want to write this as a function of w's, not of z's. So how can I do it? Well, we said last time that we will do a Fourier transform. So we have to Fourier transform everybody. And in this case, the Fourier transform is actually done over the whole space. So we have to get rid of the z's. And trade them for w's. And we have to put that formula into here. It turns out to be convenient to do it when we gauge fix one of the t's. So which one we're going to gauge fix? Let's give it a shot at gauge fix tn equals to 1. So if we gauge fix Tn equals to 1, we have dTa over Ta, the product from a equals 1 to m minus 1, delta 4 slash 4 of now you see why I chose the last one, right? Because it's nicer to write the sum from 1 to m minus 1. So we have this delta function. So we can immediately integrate Zn out, OK? So what do we get? Well, note that I could also have kept this projective. And then the Ta without gauge fixing, we have become the projective delta function. But let's not worry about that. We can always, we could do it like that if we want, but let's not do it. So I perform the Zn integral. And what do I get? Well, I still get an integral from 1 to m minus 1, d4 slash 4, Za. OK? Let me put the other integrals outside. And get e to the, so what do I get? I get, I have the sum over a from 1 to m minus 1 dot w a, right? And the nth one becomes minus I, the sum from a equals 1 to m minus 1, Ta, Za, Wn. Okay?
I have a question. What does it mean to the dot Zw?
Very good. It means whatever product that I have to do with a correct sign in order to go from one space to the other. Remember that.
But then those were lambdas and lambda cubes.
Well, some of them, right? So the lambda has to be dotted with the mu of this guy. I was careful, checking your notes, I was careful to put them in different orderings. Right? The W's, let's write it again. The WA was mu A, lambda tilde A, right? And the ZA had the lambda first, right? So when we dot them, they make sense. One is the conjugate of the other. Do you agree? Yeah, it was on purpose that I chose that convention. Because I knew you were going to ask right at this point. So that works out. By the way, nobody asked that, but I've been doing something implicitly. Motivated by the way the bosonic variables behave, I'm already defining for you the fact that the etas and the eta tildes are conjugate Grassmann variables to each other, right? So I'm already defining that to be true. Okay, so we now want to do this, and what do we get? Well, we get a bunch of delta functions, right? What delta functions do we get? Well, we get one for each integral. And the delta functions are telling us what? Are telling us that WA has to be equal projectively to WN. Do you agree? Now note something here. This formula was supposed to be cyclic invariant, right? That's a symmetry of this object. According to the color ordering, we should at least get something that is cyclic, and it doesn't look cyclic. How can we make it cyclic? Now, in this case, I would really No, I shouldn't say I will buy you a dinner because because that's something that I can actually do. If somebody can come out with a way of making this cyclic invariant. So you know the trick. The trick is to introduce redundancy. The question is what redundancy you have to introduce. This is really, I would be impressed.
DTN over TN.
Now that clearly doesn't do it, right? What time did I start? 4:30. Okay. Okay, so we don't have too much time, so I'll have to tell you about it. Well, I'll give you a hint. Let's write these equations as a matrix equation. Okay? So I want to think about the W's as a vector. And I want to write a matrix so that the answer will be the vector of equations that I get that are imposed by this delta function. So what should the matrix be? First of all, it's an m minus 1 matrix by m matrix. Right? Well, the first component is clearly 1, 0, 0, minus TA, minus T1. The second component is 0, 1, 0, okay? Well, to give you one more hint of how this thing is going to happen, in this case, when we got something that was not gauge fixed, the matrix of equations was something of the form. Imagine that you gauge fix T1 equals to 1, so you get 1, T2, T3 times the W's. Or in fact, we can do it for any number of particles so that it would look closer to that one. 1, T2, up to Tn, times W, Wn. So this is a 1 by M matrix. So what was the redundancy we had to introduce in this case? It was a GL1 redundancy. Now I told you the answer. We have to introduce what seems to be like a monster. You have to introduce a GLM minus 1 redundancy in order to recover the cyclic symmetry, the cyclic invariance of the formula. You'd say, well, how can we do that? This definitely doesn't look like anything. Well, imagine that we had a GLM minus 1 invariance of the formula. That means that we can apply a GLM transformation. In fact, this set of equations is invariant under any GLM minus 1 transformation I make, right? So you can clearly see that I can send this set of guys to be anywhere I like, because I can perform a GLN transformation that sets to the identity any column that I want. Okay? That's an invariance of this set of equations. That means already that the equation is, or the formula, is secretly cyclic, right? So I can put these guys anywhere that I like. In fact, it's telling us that this thing has even more symmetry than even the cyclic invariance. But that's the only thing we worry about because this is color order. Now, in order to make the rest of the integral cyclic invariant, in order to make it GL minus 1 invariant, we'll have to do something that looks dramatic. But it's completely fine. After a while, you realize that there is nothing to it. So we want to write the integral. GLM minus 1 invariant upwards. So we want to write the integral in terms of GLN minus 1 invariant object. So let's start with something simpler. SLM minus 1 invariant. Out of my matrix here, how can I construct SLN minus 1 invariant objects? If you're given an M minus 1 by M matrix, and you are told that there is a SLM minus 1 acting on the left, what kind of object you can build out of these metrics that are invariant under SLM minus 1? Well, that clearly would be determinants, right? You take any set of M minus 1 columns, you make a determinant with those guys, and you apply this transformation, and that will not change that determinant. So these SLM minus 1 invariant objects are the M minus 1 by M minus 1 minors of our matrix. So just for fun, let's compute who they are. Well, some of them, because it would be too much to compute all of them. But let me denote by, say 1, 2, up to M minus 1, the minor that I get by deleting the last column, okay? So I get an M by M, M minus 1 by M minus 1 matrix. I can compute its determinant. So this would be the determinant. So this will be the determinant of everything that I see except the last column. Well, that happens to be the identity. This is 1. That's great. How about the next one? Anyone? What would that be? So it's the determinant of the matrix that I get by removing the first column. Well, that's, I guess, T1, 3, 4, up to 1, T2, all the way to M minus 1, 1, and this one will give me TM minus 1. Well, you see, these guys are the ones that appear in the denominator. So what if, in order to define my object in a way that makes cyclic invariant manifest, I do the following. I say, well, I have to divide by the volume of GLM minus 1, and I'm going to integrate over a large amount of redundancy. Well, this guy, the dimension of this group is M minus 1 squared. So with M minus 1 squared redundancies, I can complete this matrix to be any general M minus 1 by M matrix. So I can actually complete the whole matrix into a matrix with all these elements in. Okay, because using a GLM minus 1 transformation, I can take this matrix into the matrix that I have over there. So using the full redundancy, I can integrate over the space of all these matrices. And here comes the reason for my silly notation before. I want to denote the row space by alpha and the column space by A. So A goes from 1 to N, and alpha goes from 1 to N minus 1. Okay? So this is my space. And you see that now the minors, or the denominators, happen to be the minors of that matrix. Well, I can put this one in, because it's 1. That's like the, like this one. Here it was 1, but we put it in because we wanted to have cyclic invariants. So we had to put it back in the formula once we put in the GL1. Here, too, we want cyclic invariants. So this one goes from 2 to the m, to m minus 1, then 2, m minus 1, n, then 3 to n, and then 1. And then you keep going until the last guy becomes m minus 1, 1, and so on. And all these delta functions, let me now introduce the index alpha. Simply become this object. OK? Now you know why I was willing to buy dinner to anyone who can who could guess this. Yes. Oh. Oh, yes. Thank you. Yes. This one should start with that. That qualifies for a coffee. OK. So it looks incredibly complicated. All we had to do to get something to get something cyclic. OK? But it turns out that this formula will be at the heart of everything that we're going to do. So it was worth getting it like this. Okay. Now let's, since you guys didn't talk about the R charge, let's actually introduce what can be called a poor man's substitute for of that, which is that let's define K to be the number of negative helicity minor, the negative helicity particles in the all gluon component of the superamplitude. Okay, sounds very complicated, but it's not that complicated. Let's look at this MHP bar amplitude. We said that if we only consider the amplitudes with gluons, we get something non-zero if we consider this amplitude, right? So this is the one that is contained here. If we put minus minus plus, we will get 0. That means that the minus minus plus is not containing here, but this one is. So what will be k for this amplitude? According to my strange definition, will be the number of negative helicity particles in this amplitude. So k would be 1. We only have 1 negative helicity particle. So this guy will have k equals to 1. So y vertices have k equals 1. What would be the k of this guy? Well, let's ask a simpler question. What is the k of just a black vertex? This guy contains the amplitude minus 1, minus 1, plus 1. So that means that we have 2 minuses. So k is equal to 2. Any guesses for what k is in this case? Well, it turns out to be n minus 1. Now you see that there is a correlation between n k and the GL redundancy we have. And that's the reason I chose to write everything in W space. Because this is k equals 1, and we have a GL1 redundancy. That is k equals n minus 1, and we have a GLn minus 1 redundancy. OK. So let's actually specialize to the three-particle object. After all, that's our building block. So now we can immediately write what this is. It's going to be 1 over the volume of GL2, right? Because it's k equals 2. Or from our formula, we know that this is, we need a GL2 redundancy, integral over all these parameters. So we have 2 times 3 of them over the minors of the matrix 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 1. So that looks nicer than the general formula. And we have product alpha 1 to 2, delta 4 slash 4, of the sum over C alpha A, W A, for A going to 1 to 3. OK, that's the formula we wanted. Now we are ready to start putting together black and white vertices. They now live in the same space. So we can do the same thing we did for white-white or black-black. We can now put the vertices together and simply integrate out the intermediate line. Okay. Well, let's give it a shot. We would like to do this as the simplest case. But since we're running a little bit out of time, let's actually do something more complicated. So this is going to be it's going to be actually dangerous, but if it doesn't work, if I don't get it to work, it's always an exercise for you. Okay? So you better help me now so that it won't be an exercise. So we want to compute this object. Okay? Because that one is too easy. The first thing we have to do is to label the internal particles. So let me label them as A, B, C, and D. Okay? And all we have to do is to write these 4 integrals. We have to gauge fix them first, and then integrate out these guys by recognizing delta functions. Okay? Yeah, it sounds easy, but let's see how easy it is. So let me do something before that might actually help. So I'm going to introduce a notation for gauge fixing. The notation will be the following. If I have a white vertex, I have to gauge fix only one variable, right? I only have to gauge fix one of the columns, and I have to choose which one. So I'm going to denote that as a line that is incoming, and the guys that I'm not gauge fixing as lines that are outgoing. Okay. Now, for a black vertex, I have to choose 2 of the columns to be the identity matrix, right? So that's the gauge fixing. The whole GL2 redundancy allows me to gauge fix two of the columns to be the identity matrix and the remaining two to be free variables. So I'm going to choose the ones that I'm going to gauge fix to represent lines that are incoming, and the one that I'm not gauge fixing as the line that is outgoing. So these are the gauge fix guys, and this is the gauge fix guy. That's just to keep track of what I'm doing. So in this case, imagine that I say these two guys, I'm going to gauge fix these two guys. Okay? If I gauge fix these two guys, then know that these guys, So these guys are not gauge fixed, and these guys are not gauge fixed. But if my arrows mean anything, it would mean that these two guys are gauge fixed in this vertex, and this guy should not be gauge fixed, and this guy should not be gauge fixed. Okay? So what I'm doing here, this funny way of putting arrows in a diagram, is something that mathematicians call a perfect orientation. And the reason it's called perfect is that I just made up some rule for defining orientations for black and white vertices, and it's called perfect because it actually makes sense in the diagram, right? I didn't find any contradiction. I could have found a contradiction, but I didn't. How could I have found a contradiction with the orientations? No, but I could have found a contradiction if I had assumed that these two guys, if I had started by saying that these two guys were incoming and this one was also incoming, say, from the beginning. And then I started to draw the orientations and I would find a contradiction. So that would not be perfect. It would meet a contradiction. So it's a perfect orientation if everything works out fine according to the rule that I gave. Okay? It turns out that for any of the graphs that we're going to draw, in general, there is always a perfect orientation. Moreover, there will be a perfect orientation that is acyclic, meaning that you will not find any loops in the diagram that are consistent with the orientations of the arrows. So in this case, clearly there is no loop in the diagram, right? Very good. So let's try. So let's start with these guys, okay? So I said, well, first of all, let's try to do something more or less symmetric. Let's start with ZA and Z and WA and WC, okay? And let's write these three particle vertices. So we have DT. This one, we chose to gauge fix this one, so we have to leave these two. So that would be TA over TA, DTB over TB, delta 4/4, and we get W2, TA, TB, TB. So that would be this vertex. Now I can also write this one down, and it's DTC over TC, DTD over TD, delta 4/4, W4 plus TC WC plus TD WD. Okay? Pretty good. So, what would be the next step? So, of course, this is only part of the object. I'm only written part of it. Well, as we did before in the emergence, the idea is to identify some of these guys together with some of these guys in order to produce fancy projective delta functions. Right? So we can immediately take this guy together with this and this guy together with this to produce delta functions. and integrate them. So together with this, and here, we can do this guy with this guy. Okay? In other words, I'm going to write this like this with a supersymmetric with a projective delta function that tells me that WA is nothing but this. Okay? And I'll have the integral over WC. With the corresponding integrals over TB and TV. Okay? Very good. So now I can integrate this out of the whole diagram using my delta functions. So I have to start by writing these guys. So these vertices will now be, and I engage fixing these guys, right? So what would that be? Fixing this gauge fixing these guys means that if I have the matrix AD1, I'm gauge fixing these guys to be 0, 1, 1, 0, and 0, 1. And these other two guys, degrees of freedom, let me call them x and y. They can be anything that I want. So I'm supposed to integrate over them. You can check that that's what happens with the minors, with the consecutive minors in the formula over here. Okay. So the more tired you look, the greater are the chances I'm going to assign this as a homework. So you better start looking very enthusiastic and say, wow, yeah, this is going to work. It's just incredible. Things like that will make me continue. Excellent, yes. Very good. So one of the delta functions is this thing, and the other one is this one. So you have WA plus X W1 delta 4 slash 4 WD plus Y W1, right? But WA has already been fixed by this delta function. So you can remove it from here and instead write this thing. W2 plus TB WB plus X W1. Here, nothing to do. Now let's write the next one. This one would be my perfect orientation tells me to gauge fix. If I call this B, C, and this 3, tells me to use 0, 1, 1, 0 here. And then to introduce some other variables, Z and W. Okay, integrate over them and put the supersymmetric delta functions, two of them, one for each equation, WB plus ZW3 and delta 4 slash 4 WC, but WC has already been gauge fixed, so it's W4 plus TB WD plus little w, w3. Okay? We shouldn't forget these integrations that are still there. This is almost our final answer. Okay? Why? Because we still have internal objects, B and D. So we still have to integrate over them. Now this is this is what we want to compute. It's not yet our final answer, but it is what we want to compute. Okay, what's next? Next, we want to carry out these guys with some of these delta functions, right? Well, this one is begging you. I mean, the formula is telling you what to do, right? And you look at the formula and it's talking to you. It's telling you you should use this and this. Okay. So if that's what the formula wants, let's do it. That's what this formula wants. I'm not sure that is the correct formula, but let's do it. And I forgot these other two integration variables, right? Oh, no, they are here, sorry. Yeah, no, I did. So far it looks correct. So let's keep going. So let's use those delta functions to perform those integrations. So what integrations we're going to do? Z and Y. Okay? So we're going to do this integration and this integration. So we're going to be left with dTb over Td, dx over x, and dw, little w over w, delta 4/4, w2 plus tb, wb, but wb will be substituted by zw3. And don't complain about the sign, because this is all projective, and the sign doesn't matter, plus w1, my last delta function is delta 4/4, w4, plus td, wd, which is y, w1, plus w3. Okay, that's what we got. Doesn't look like anything nice. And it's supposed to be nice. But let's do the same thing that we did before. Let's write the system of equations and see what happens. This is x, 1, dbz, 0. So we are writing this equation as an equation acting as a matrix acting on this vector. And now the next equation is y, Td, 0, Td, y, 1. Not bad, huh? Isn't this looking, again, like a gauge-fix matrix already? Something that we already used a GL2 invariance to gauge-fix this to be the identity matrix. Well, if that was the case, right, minors of this matrix better appear in the denominator of this object. So let's just compute and see. Now is the dangerous part. Oh, where? This here? Oh, there are no z's. What am I doing? Right?
It's even up when you go to the projective data function, right?
Oh, yeah, I copied this z. Yeah, but there is no z. This goes away in the projective. Yeah, thank you. Yes, there is no z here. Now this is looking even better. Oh, there is no y, right? Oh, sorry, what did I do? Oh, I erased the wrong one and put a td, which was not td, was w. Please, how many people? Somebody should tell. Very good, you did. I was about to compute the minors and get them all wrong. And this is all on camera. This is embarrassing. Yeah, that's why this business of recording things is it's not such a great idea.
Don't talk too much.
Yeah, don't talk too much, yes. So, and don't make too many mistakes. So this is the matrix, right? I need somebody to say yes, so it's your whoever fault it is to say yes. Okay. Okay, so let's compute minors of that matrix. How about 1, 2, the 1, 2 minor? Well, it's the determinant of this matrix. That looks like TD. 2, 3. 2, 3 looks like little w. 3, 4. 3, 4 looks like t b. And 4, 1 definitely looks like x. Not bad, huh? Exactly the guys that appear in the denominator. So I can do my favorite thing, which is to introduce volume of GL2, a full GL2 redundancy. Pretend that these guys are completely general, okay? So I'm going to replace this by a matrix C11, C12, C13, C14, C21, C22, C23, C24. Completely general. If I want to recover this, all I have to do is to use the GL2 redundancy to make this identity. But it seems that I can do whatever I want. Not only that, but I can do exact whatever I want. So I have this guy. I integrate over all these guys. 2 times 4 C alpha A divided by 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, 1 times the product or alpha from 1 to 2. Delta 4 slash 4, sum over C alpha A, W A from A, 1, 2, 4. Now you're all supposed to be crying from the excitement and the passion of seeing such a beautiful formula come out of such a crazy computation. Yeah, I guess nowadays people are not amused by it.
I have a question. This margin exponent thing that you told us for the 4-point amplitude, that this also works for n point, I suppose, for with the same color, right? All black or all white?
Right, but now that this is quite different, right? This object is very different. This object now doesn't have the same structure. It was supposed to be n minus 1. So here we have 4 particles. So this in this case, it would be 3 by 4. This is a 2 by 4. Yes. So what is this object? What is the k of this object? The k of this object is 2. What could it be? Could it have any physical meaning? Before discovering the physical meaning of this guy, let's do something. Since this was so easy, let's start all over again, but now do this one. Do I have to? First of all, do you see the... Yeah, let's remove my perfect orientation from here. Okay. What if I had started with this diagram? Would it have made any difference? No. Look, the answer is completely cyclic. So we just discovered an identity of on-shell diagrams. So this is an example of something that was discovered by physicists almost simultaneously as mathematicians. So mathematicians were doing combinatorics, and physicists were doing this. But we will adopt the name that mathematicians gave just because they beat us by a month or so. So they scoop us. So we'll use their name. It's called the square identity. And it turns out that this identity, a merge and expand, can be proven to be the only identities that on-shell diagrams satisfy, or these diagrams we're going to be dealing with. So we just did today all the possible identities that can be used in any on-shell diagram that will transform one into another one, which contain the same, in such a way that they contain the same physical information.
Yes.
I just told you the only two identities that are true. This identity merge and expand trees of the same color. Those are the only two identities. So you take your favorite diagram and you apply those identities. Any diagram that you get by only applying those identities will give you something that has the same physical information. So you can answer your question yourself. Is it possible to connect one to the other by doing this? The answer is yes, they are the same physical information. But what physical information? I haven't told you, right? So let's actually see what that thing is. So anybody who thinks in dual super twister space will know what this is. But since I don't think in dual super twister space, I have to go back always to momentum space to at least recognize formulas, right? So let's go back to momentum space and see what that is. So back to momentum space. Well, what do I have to do to go back to momentum space? We said that these WAs are objects of this form. Right? So this we can live with. This guy is already in momentum space. The only guy that is not in momentum space is this one. So we have to perform the inverse Fourier transform to go back to momentum space. So let's actually do it. So what do we get? We get 1 over volume GL2 integral D2 times 4 C alpha A 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, 1. Integral, okay. Let's pull out from those delta functions everything that will stay there. We said we don't want to do anything with the lambda tilde variables. And we said we don't want to do anything with the supersymmetric guys. And all we want to do is to Fourier transform all the mu a variables from 1 to 4. Back to the lambdas. Yeah, I wonder why this notation looks so awkward now. The tilde and the, but I guess that's how I chose it, right? Okay, well, that seems to be live. Now, I have to write the remaining delta functions, but in order to write them, so we have delta functions of the form sum over C alpha A mu A, okay? So in order to carry out these integrations, let me represent them. So we have one for each alpha. So let me represent them in terms of an integral. So I'm going to introduce rho alpha, which is a spinner, and I'm going to represent this as a in its integral representation. So I'm going to write product over alpha from 1 to 2, d2 rho alpha, and I get two of these guys. So I get I sum over C alpha A where there is a sum over alpha 2, right? All right, so now what can we do? Well, we can immediately perform the mu tilde delta function, the mu tilde integrations. They just give me delta functions. So in this whole business, all these integrations are trivial. That's good. Not complaining. Okay, so when I do that, get 1 over the volume. We don't have time to write the whole 1 over the volume. Let's just look at what this is. Let's call it M. So M is the product. First of all, we have the integral over alpha over these auxiliary spinors. Now, remember again that this thing is a spinor, so it has an alpha bar index. I told you I was never going to write the alpha bar index again, but this is an exception to the rule. Just so that you see that what these two means. These two means that there are two components. And I get product from A1 to 4, delta 2, rho alpha, C alpha A, minus lambda A. That's what I get. That's my M. Very good. This is all very nice. Now let's try to think about this more geometrically and say, well, look at this. This is a two by four matrix. C22, C23, C24. And these delta functions are telling me that this matrix, linear combinations of these two row vectors, so let me call this C1, C2, where C1 and C2 belong to C4, or R4, just preventing any. So these are two vectors that belong to C4, right? Now this equation is telling me that some linear combination of these two guys happens to be a vector that I can get if I were to write the lambdas of each particle of particle 1. So this index here is the alpha bar index. Shoot, I had to do it again. Okay? So if I choose this to be my matrix and call this vectors in C4, these delta functions are telling me nothing but the fact that a linear combination of these two guys happens to produce this vector. And another linear combination of these two guys happens to produce this vector. Linear combinations. So what do I learn from this? Well, any minor of this matrix what is the relationship between a minor of this matrix and a minor of this matrix? If I'm telling you that the two are related by a GL2 transformation.
It's invariant.
Well, not quite. This is invariant under SL2, but not GL2. So there will be a rescaling. So I should allow for a rescaling. So these guys are proportional. Let's not use alpha. Let's use gamma. With the same gamma for everything is independent of A and B, these guys are proportional to the minors of this matrix. But the minors of this matrix are nothing but the square, but the angular brackets, right? Very good. So this is just a constant of proportionality and it's fixed, okay? Well, let's also see something else here. This equation is telling us that the lambda tildes also want to form a matrix. But what's the relationship with the C's? Well, those delta functions are telling you that these vectors are orthogonal to these vectors. right? That's what these delta functions are telling you. Well, if these guys are orthogonal to these guys, and these guys are proportional to these guys, guess what? These delta functions are telling you that these guys and these guys are orthogonal to each other. Can anybody recognize what that means? Well, orthogonal in the sense that if you take this guy dot this guy, you get zero. If you take this guy dot this guy, you also get zero. And the same thing for these guys. So it implies there's four equations. Nobody recognizes them yet? Okay. Well, let's now write them explicitly. So what is this equation? So let's actually write these equations in a more condensed form. Okay? Remember, these indices are these bar indices that I chose. Okay? So all these equations can be written like this. With alpha bar and alpha dot bar going from 1 to 2. So I get four equations. So let's write them explicitly. Well, explicitly I have to sum over all the components, right? That's what the dot means. So I get sum over A from 1 to 4, lambda A, and this has to be equal to 0. Yes, excellent. It's momentum conservation. So momentum conservation came out of nowhere somehow, so it ended up happening to be there. So we get momentum conservation. These delta functions are telling you that this object has vanishing support unless only has support on momentum conserving data. Okay? So whatever it is, so whatever our object is, it has a momentum conservation delta function in it. Okay? It has these minors in the denominator, but they are all proportional to the angular brackets, right? It also has this supersymmetric guy. But this supersymmetric guy, remember, this product over alpha from alpha 1 to 2 is GL invariant. Or SL invariant, really. So we can take linear combinations of this thing and still get the same delta functions. So linear combinations of the C's, we concluded that they happen to be the lambdas. So these delta functions end up being delta functions telling us that the lambdas must satisfy this equation. So I'll change the notation again. I'll put the A down because I like it like that. So that's. But this is a delta function with two indices here and four indices here. So this guy has four indices. This guy has two indices. And therefore, this is a A-dimensional delta function. Now, the exercise for you is to show that after you do all these integrals, there could be just a Jacobian sitting here. And the Jacobian happens to be 1. So this object is identical to this object. Can anybody recognize what this is? It's a supersymmetric version of an MHB four-particle amplitude. So let me clean it up a little bit. But at what level in perturbation theory? Three level. Isn't that funny? This doesn't look like a three level object. But everything is on shell. So that's the key. So this is a three level. MHP 4-point amplitude, which happens to be equal to the sum of these three Feynman diagrams. So somehow we have succeeded in encapsulating all the off-shell information that goes into these propagators. And it has been actually better for us, because instead of summing over three diagrams, we have a single diagram. Now, we said that these things, the three-part, but OK, so here is a question for you. How come that I got this answer, and we said the three-particle amplitudes actually vanish? And this is the answer for real momenta, right? So how is that possible? Yeah, but this is momentum conservation for four particles. Sorry, I was already writing. So four particles are not constrained to anything. S, T, and U are just constrained by S plus T plus U equal to zero. They no other constraints. So real momenta, everything. I'm asking, the question is, how come that this answer is non-zero if it's made out of three particle amplitudes put together, and we said the three particle amplitudes vanish? For real momenta. That's the answer. Excellent. So the trick to go on shell to write the sum of Feynman diagrams, which are all off shells, off shell objects. So the trick to encapsulate off shell information in on shell information is to allow these guys to be complex. So somehow we are discovering that there is some sort of new physical way of thinking about things, where external data, they are all real, and somehow the processes are all on shell but happening outside of the real slide. They are actually happening, but happening as physical processes in the complexified space. Is that all in our minds? Most probably, but it's actually very interesting that that's the description of what's happening. And if you want to do everything in real space, then you have to introduce gauge redundancies and off-shell information and all the complication that comes with it. Okay. So let me just finish today by giving you an exercise. Okay. And I cannot be doing all the work here. You should also do something. Yes?
Just the three level, the 4-point.
Sorry?
The 4-point amplitude and 4-point on-shell amplitude in just three level without
yes.
Box. And it should give also the same without. Or
if I do what, sorry?
Just the three level without the box.
Oh, brilliant. Yeah. So what was the thing that I said was too easy? Yeah, very good question. What is this, guys? Well, if you repeat the same exercise we did, you're going to end up with a matrix just like this one, that you will encounter one difference. The one difference is that you will find out that 1 and 2 happen to be proportional to each other. In other words, you will find that TD is equal to 0. That means that minor 1, 2 actually vanishes for that diagram. Now, 1, 2 vanishing, if you remember the translation we made, which is not there anymore, but we said that this minor had to be proportional to the angular brackets. So that would mean what? That the angular bracket is vanishing. So in this diagram will correspond to something where 1, 2 is equal to 0. But 1, 2 equals to 0 means S is equal to 0, right? So what's this object? Is the factorization channel in the S channel of a four-particle amplitude. So this is the singular configuration of a factorization channel. The S factorization channel of the four-point amplitude. So that's what that is.
So a triangle diagram with two black and one white will be zero also?
If you put it inside an object, this thing can actually do interesting things. In fact, it's equivalent to this, right? By the merging and expanding operation, it's actually equivalent to this. Tomorrow we will see what they mean. Outside of a diagram, yes, they are zero. But inside of a diagram, they can do interesting things. So let me give you the exercise and we'll finish with that. So here it is. One, show that if you have anything like this, where this diagram is MHP, is a K equals 2 object. I'm going to tell you how to count the K of a diagram. So given this object, attaching this to it, so maybe I should have written what the object was first. So show that given a K equals 2 diagram with legs A and B, so this is where legs A and B used to be, okay? So show that this is equal to the same object that you had before. So this is in momentum space, times AB over AC times CB, times the old momentum conservation that you had, plus the new guy. And the same goes through for the supersymmetric one. So you're also introducing a new, so this is the all, this is the all, okay? Well, to the inverse operation of a soft limit. That's why this is called the inverse soft act. So So we are attaching an inverse subfactor to this object and building a new object. Okay? So given this, so once you do this, even if you don't do this, because you might think that it's too complicated, you can just use it to show that if you have this guy as your k equals 2 object, and you attach to it an inverse subfactor of this form, in between 3 and 4, and now, of course, it would be nice to relabel that. So put a 4 here and 5 here. Guess what this is? This is the MHB 3-level Park-Taylor formula. Well, but this exercise is very trivial once you know this. So more interesting is to show that not only this, but also that this is cyclic invariant using the two operations we found today. So what are the operations? You can perform a square moves, because you have a box here. In other words, you can change the colors. And you can take any tree of the same color and contract it and expand it. Okay? So play that game. Take this diagram. Contract, expand. You will see that you get another diagram that looks very different from the original one. Now perform a square move first, and then contract and expand, and you will get another diagram. So keep doing that until you can show that from this diagram you can go to any other diagram where the labels are exactly where the labels have been shifted by one. So the diagram, just by using these two operations, can be shown to be cyclic invariant. Okay? And if you feel like it, this operation, this inverse subfactor, tells you how to construct any MHB amplitude, right? In many different ways, because it tells you that you can attach it to anything you like. You can construct the six particle one by attaching the inverse subfactor here, here, anywhere you like, and relabeling. Okay? So I guess this is a good place to stop. Yeah, tomorrow we will see that there is a deeper connection. Yeah, so we will answer the question of, we will define a new operation, which is actually the only other one that we will need, which is that if you have any object, what is the meaning of attaching to it something like this? And this will give rise to BCFW.